So I'm Steen, and I'm talking about how to go F without a hitch, which deals with efficient compilation from F to OCaml. So just to get on the same page, F is a programming language with algebraic effects. I'm sure by now we all know what a programming language is, so I'll introduce to you what effects actually are, more specifically computational effects, by listing some examples. First of all, we have the throwing of exceptions as a computational effect for which we use keywords like throw and to actually throw expressions and then try catch to capture them, and actually is thrown by a program. Then we have global state manipulation as a second example, and there we use operations like get and set to respectively read from or write to global storage or global variables. And then finally, we have I/O operations, which are also considered computational effects. And examples there are reading from user inputs or printing some output information to the user, which we all know as well. Of course, many more examples of effects exist, and some languages like F even allow you to define your own effects. But I think these kind of paint the picture of what they actually are. Now, to zoom in on these keywords, most of them actually are what we call operations. They actually cause the effectful or impure behavior of a program. But then the try-catch keyword represents a different concept, namely that of handlers, which actually capture the impure behavior and then define what to do when an effect actually occurs. But now, what are algebraic effects, which we use in F? Now, I told you 5 seconds ago what computational effects are. But when dealing with algebraic effects, we actually generalize this try-catch mechanism to be used on all effects. So not only on throwing exceptions, but also on doing a get, a set, an I/O operation, or anything else. And there we use the handle with keyword, or something like that, which means we handle some computation, which we fill in here, with some handler, which we define in the program as well. But now here's our hitch. How do we compile such things? How do we deal with both the operations, which cause the effectful behavior, and then the handlers that do something with it? They capture it and then do some computation to handle these effects. To answer this question, we'll look at actual F compilation, which uses these algebraic effects. But before we can do that, we of course have to ask ourselves what F and actually understand what F actually is. And that's what I'll illustrate in this small example program. There, first of all, we have this definition of an effect that just flips a coin, and we define it as an operation that takes 0 arguments and then evaluates to a boolean. Then we define a handler, which is an actual coin flipper, and in we arbitrarily choose to flip the coin to true. So feed true to the computation which throws the effect of flipping a coin. And then finally, the last part of this program is the actual interesting part. It's the computation. And there we use this handle with keywords. We handle this simple if-then-else computation with the coin flipper we just defined. So now, when we actually evaluate this computation, we execute it, we look at this if-then-else statement, and then, of course, we start by evaluating the if clause. Because we are using this coin flipper as a handler for the computation, we evaluate this coin flipping to true, meaning this evaluates to true, meaning we evaluate the then branch, which is very simple. It's just one. So this entire program evaluates to one. This is easy. We all understand this. But now, how do we compile this? How do we get this effectful program with a handler to a more low-level, for example, OCaml program? And of course, how do we do this efficiently? A very naive approach to this is taking the if-then-else statement we just had in F, and there we also used the handler that looks at this computation and handles it. And then we can just sequence this computation by using monadic bind operators in OCaml. So we just take each little part of the computation and execute it sequentially. And that's what we express by these monadic binds. And then in OCaml, we can define this OCaml equivalent of the F handler. And this can just look at each part of the sequence and actually handle it like it's defined in the program. Now, here's our next hitch. The fact that these monadic binds are very expensive operations, the performance of the code is quite low when you use these because they do take some time. And in this case, we know this last part of the computation, which we sequence with these monadic binds, is a pure computation. It's just 3 plus 2. So these two binds aren't even necessary. We can just do them and replace this with the let in, which is way less performance intensive. We need less time to do a let in than to do a monadic bind. So this is our goal, to do this computation, this compilation from F to OCaml with some knowledge about the effects that are thrown, such that we can be aware of this purity and get to let in instead of these monadic binds, for example. But how do we do this? We actually keep track of this effect information. So while going from F to OCaml, we at each point want to know which part of the program has some effects and which don't, and which we can see as pure computations and which we can't. So how do we do this? Originally, we introduced this intermediary language called impf in the compiler of F. And impf, as its name suggests, is an implicitly typed language which kind of resembles F. So as you can see, if we have just a very simple function term in F, its equivalent in impf is very similar and actually just the same. But here we face this issue of impf being implicitly typed, and that poses some challenges in transforming impf or transforming impf to multicore OCaml, which is our target language. These types are implicit in their terms, so it's quite hard to do a correct translation from impf to multicore OCaml. This has been implemented and it was very buggy and error prone. So we needed something else. More specifically, we introduced two new intermediary languages called XF and Scalf. And then XF, of course, as its name suggests again, is explicitly typed. So there we make the effects and the typing and the subtyping information all explicit in the terms and in the programs. So we, as you can see, these terms we had in F and impf become quite large in XF because we do these explicit typing and subtyping. And that information actually is quite easy to use in these transformations. Because it's explicit, we can just use it. It's not like an impf that we have to think about it. It's there. It's on the paper or in the program. But then that's all nice and well, but we don't actually need this extra information when dealing with Carl Camel. It doesn't care about the explicit effects or explicit subtyping. So that's why we introduced this extra intermediary language, which gets rid of all the redundant information. And this one actually, the Scalf, is quite close to multicore OCaml. So in that way, we have this full backend branch of the compiler from F to multicore OCaml. Through all these languages we know and that are proven to be correct. This is all fine, but there's a new hitch here. Namely, the fact that multicore OCaml still has an effect system. It does natively support these computational effects we talked about. And to be as general as possible, we would also like a backend that translates to pure languages or pure fragments of languages like Plano Camel or even like Haskell in the future, which would make the compiler, the F compiler, more general. But of course, this is quite a difficult problem because F, of course, has effects and pure languages don't, making this a non-trivial problem. We do know about XF. We did know about Scalf, but they both had effects, so we can't just use them again to translate to Plano Camel. That's kind of the domain of ongoing research, to get some way to some calculus or some new intermediary languages that can get us from an effectful to pure languages. But what we already have established is NoF. It's yet another intermediary language, and again, as its name suggests, it doesn't have any native effects, so it's quite close to Plano Camel. This step, this last step, is established. It's done, we could use it. But the problem is the step before. We want to translate to NoF, and that already has been proposed, but starting from a different language than the XF that we know. It starts from this XF prime language, which has slightly different than the XF we already have in the compiler. But the syntax is as different as needed for this step, which seems quite logical now, to be non-trivial. It's quite hard to translate from XF to XF prime. So what the actual problem is that we want to marry kind of these two parts of this backend branch, this second backend branch, where we don't have any theory yet. So it's actually this step we're looking at now. We are already exploring some options, one of which is defining a transformation from XF to XF prime, which is proven to be quite hard. It has a lot of the interaction between XF and XF prime. They get this combinatorial explosion of a lot of expression forms, which all have to be handled. So it's kind of a beast, and we don't know yet whether it's possible to tame it. So it's kind of ongoing research, it's not yet decided upon. A second option could be to actually marry the two and turn them into this kind of new language, XF prime prime or something, which is an alternative to the two and could fit into this compiler backend. And the final option, of course, is to make them have a baby and have yet another intermediary language which we could put in between, and we could define transformations to and from. So yeah, this is the love story I'd like to end with. I kindly thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, please fire.